So, it's just us girls so far. Hello, Andrea Farrell.
Hi, Alison Spittle.
How are you getting on?
I'm good. It's a very hot day. I'm sweating a lot.
I'm sweating from my chin. Yeah. I've never felt proper sweat go from my chin. Or last night, I was with my boyfriend and he sweated into my mouth, like a full-on drop. Like, didn't mean to.
Was he on top of you, Alison?
No.
How did that happen?
I was cuddling him.
Oh, a cuddle.
A cuddle. Yeah. Just started with a cuddle.
Special sexual cuddle.
No, okay. You don't do that. We'll cut this out now. How dare you? This is my show. This is the So thanks so much for coming in, Andrea. For the listeners at home, this is a Dublin Fringe special. So Andrea Farrell is doing a show in the International Bar. What day is he doing, Andrea?
My preview is on the 12th of September.
Uh-huh.
So
this is euro cheaper, lads.
Come along to that. It's euro cheaper.
And but you'll be getting a euro cheaper.
Oh, actually, it's
comedy.
2 euro cheaper.
2 euro cheaper.
So you have to hold in consideration that this is a preview.
Yeah, I get you.
And then the rest of the run is the 13th until the 16th.
What time is that at?
18:45.
Ooh, 18:45.
Yeah.
I feel like you're in a radio ad and I'm like, say the name of that company again. What's the name of that company?
Andrea Farrell does comedy.
And you said there's a number. Oh, no, you know what I'm saying? So your show is called Who Loves You?
Yeah.
What's it about?
What's it about? Well, you see, the problem with the show name is I wrote the blurb and the title of the show long, long, long before I had written any content.
What? No comedian does
that. Nobody does that. But, it's a normal stand-up show, but I suppose there is a kind of meandering theme of... me and depression and anxiety, but that's just a small part of it. The rest is a hoot.
That's the tip of the mental health iceberg.
Just the tip.
Yeah. So you did a show in Whelan's before called Who Loves You. Is this like a continuation? How different is it from the Whelan's gig?
There's more of a theme in this one. I mean, the Whelan's gig, I just basically was just doing all my jokes. Whereas in this one now, I'm kind of working a lot of stories that I've told, like, my friends and my comedy peers. And just these kind of stories about my life, my family, that people have been telling me for ages that I need to work into a show.
Oh, wow.
You know, and it kind of, it suits the team. It suits the team perfectly.
And I love your poster as well. It's really nice.
That was taken by my lover.
Your lover?
My boyfriend, Pork Connaughty, and he designed the poster as well.
No, because it's beautiful, because it's got loads of lovely records around and stuff. And fair play. And is it your first time doing Tiger Fringe?
It is.
And what's it been like so far?
It's been amazing. They're just so feckin' nice in the Fringe office. They're everyone who I've been in contact with. It's like they really love you.
It is,
and because I've been involved
like
at other
you
festivals.
Matter.
Yeah, it you do feel like you matter, and with other festivals I've been involved with, I've not felt as loved.
Yeah.
As loved.
I think it's important to feel loved at a festival.
Yeah.
Like Vodafone Festival, feel loved at that.
Oh yeah.
You get a little notebook with your name engraved into it.
Yeah.
That. There's nothing better than that.
That's like getting like a love letter from somebody you fancy.
It is, isn't it?
There's something very special about that. And it's red.
Yeah, it's red as hell. You're like, oh, I'm a success. I just got an email there off Dublin Bus News. I think there's some industrial action happening.
Oh, no.
I know. I don't really mind though, because I don't really use the bus. I'm a cyclist.
Yeah, me too now. I've started cycling recently.
And just for listeners at home and stuff, like Andrea, this is a Dublin Fringe special, so Andrea will be on later on, like this year or next year, in front of a live audience. So I know this isn't the normal one.
Yeah, and then my chat will be great.
I think it makes a difference having an audience, though.
Oh yeah, it does.
It does. You tell more secrets like this.
Yeah, you get a bit more brazen and brave.
Yeah, yeah, because you're like, oh, sure, they might like to hear about this, and you can cut it out. An
it's
amount
like
of
you're
libelous
being
things. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. Of libelous things I've said, where I've got good old Sarah to cut off. So, I was going to ask you is that you, what else are you doing other than stand up at the moment?
Other than stand up, I was doing a bit of voiceover work there a while ago.
What's that like?
It's grand. It's grand. You had a little voiceover thing today now, didn't you?
Yeah.
It's weird, but it's kind of. Like you were saying, you kind of try to change your voice a bit. That's kind of, I think everyone tries to do that.
Because you feel like when I watch ads and I hear different comedians, and if they're sound, I go, oh, fair play to them. Making a bit of money for themselves, aren't they great? And if there's someone I don't like, I'm like, that shill. That terrible shill. Look at that person scraping that money off that company or whatever.
Working for the man.
Yeah, the man. They are the man. So yeah, it's a bit tough. Like you're just in a booth and you suddenly become very self-conscious of your voice and stuff.
Yeah, but your voice sounds a lot better in those special booths. Like
you do.
Because the first time I did one, I remember thinking, oh God, my voice isn't actually that bad.
Yeah.
But it's different to listen to like a voice recording that you make on your phone. You're just like, oh, Jesus Christ.
Shut up.
Whenever I listen to any recordings of myself doing stand-up, I hate it.
Oh, I do too, though. I do too. Do you know what I hate as well about recording yourself? My boyfriend, I do this joke about Junior MasterChef that the crux of the joke is, right, that my boyfriend's not funny, and he is funny.
Yeah.
And the thing is, he actually wrote that joke beside me while watching the telly. But I remembered it as, oh, that's funny. I'll write that down. So all of a sudden, it was my joke.
Yeah.
And then it took him a few months to go to me, Alison, I wrote that. I was like, what? And then I felt so bad.
Oh, God.
And so I've been trying to write it in a way now that incorporates that bit into it.
Okay.
So I don't feel so guilty. But every time I do it, I keep doing it badly at the end. And he said, did you do it in Edinburgh the way, like, you know, you wanted to. Oh wait, there. I think I know who that is.
This is Sir Davey Reilly.
Hey, Davey, I'll let you know.
Alison, do you know who owns these nuts here?
No, you.
Are they guest nuts?
Natalie Moon.
There's also, I like the HeadStuff office. It's got like biscuits, water, some tea, and I don't think anyone's laying claim to them. So I think while they're gone, Alison's gone in to get Davey. I'm going to open up these nuts. And no one's going to know. I'm just going to have some nuts. Okay, they're coming back. So I have to. Roasted, salted. These are Tesco brand nuts. They're a bit stale. Oh, Jesus.
It is, isn't it?
Oh, God, they're coming back. Hi, hey, guys.
Hey. Don't say libelous, Davey. You're on air.
Live.
We're live.
Yeah, well. We're live. Where do I sit?
You sit there, baby.
Here.
Yeah.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Welcome to the show. So, this is like not the normal Alison Spittle Show. Like, we'll have you on again with an audience and you can be classed then. This is like a...
is this all right?
Yeah, I think so.
Is that okay?
I think so, yeah. Huh. Cool. Are we clipping? How are we getting on?
It's still going and I'm still eating nuts.
Let's go.
So, Alison nipped out and you started eating nuts?
Yeah. We're just
don't edit that out.
That's between me and the listeners.
So, Dave, you're doing the Dublin Fringe as well. Tell me a bit about your show. When is it on and where is it on?
It is on the 19th to the 24th of September, downstairs in the Stag's Head.
Ooh, so you're doing the Inter, and that's like a proper comedy club, and the Stag's Head is like home of Comedy Crunch, which is a proper comedy club as well. Mm. What time are you doing your shows at?
6:45.
And you're doing 6:45?
Yeah.
Same perfect. Week?
Not the same week, though.
Oh.
Ah, nice.
Perfect.
Nice.
You're the first week.
Yeah. Who's on in your venue as well? Who
it's me and Grode. Grode's there in the first week. Grode Farley.
Oh, yeah, lovely.
It's so annoying. Now, this is the one pitfall of comedy at the fringe. My show is in the same time as Grode's, and I really want to see Grode's show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because it's called Things.
So Neil May happy.
And who's on in your venue the other week?
It's Emma Doran.
Emma Doran is on the week after, yeah. Yeah. I think
cool.
that's it.
Cool.
And then
cool,
Joanne
cool.
is in the project.
She's in the project,
I think that's the stand up then?
Is there.
She's on a little later, around the 19th.
Ah. Is she's on the evening as well, isn't she? Like, not 6:45.
Yeah, later. I think she's on about 7 or 8 or something.
And then we got Foil Arms and Hog as well. And they obviously do Fringe each year.
Oh, yeah.
Is there anyone else from the comedy world we can think of now? Lords of Strut?
Mimes in Time.
Oh yeah, Mimes in Time.
We're
doing a show. Yeah.
They're so good. They're in the Science Gallery.
Yeah,
they're gonna be class. I think that's every stand up. Like, there's probably one now that we haven't thought of.
Some feel like terrible someone from people. Like Carlo that's doing great things down the country that we're just ignorant and Dublin centric and ignoring.
No, totally.
Yeah,
like this is at a this. I forget that this podcast is going out to a wider audience than Dublin. I'm so sorry.
No,
guys.
No, geez,
There's a lad called Dick Walsh, and he's doing like.
That show looks brilliant.
Looks so good. What's it called?
It's
George Bush and His Children.
George Bush's Children, yeah.
And they're getting scripts of talk shows, like American talk shows, where they talk about light stuff and even like the abortion debate and stuff. Mm. And it's all a bit. And Dick Walsh is mad.
So they're acting out.
He's an absolute head case.
Yeah.
Scripts, is it?
Yeah, I like they're acting it out as if it's one long. I think. No, I met him in the Fringe box office, and there was a box of donuts on the table because it was like the first day. So I was eating a donut while he was telling me.
Yeah.
So I wasn't concentrating as much as I should have been.
You didn't go to a show and be disappointed by the lack
donuts,
of donuts.
The donuts were huge, and I was like, I'm not going to be able to finish this. That's what I said out loud, but I knew that I would be able to finish
Where were the donuts from? Good. I'm after having one. I'm a big donut fan. Where?
Did you go?
No, if I had a bit more time, I was planning on nipping to the one downstairs from here.
It's so good.
It's pretty good.
I think they said they were Polish donuts.
Imported.
I don't know.
Maybe they were like polished donuts.
No, they said they were. Oh, these are real Polish donuts or something.
Hole donuts. There's holes in them.
No, they weren't. There weren't holes. They were big.
Like a polo.
It was the size of a baby's head. Was one of them.
So you want out of a donut, though, isn't it?
Huh?
That's what you want out of a donut.
Yeah. I like the ring ones, though, because I can put my finger in it and just kind of have it resting on my finger. And your hand
Work
gets less sticky.
Like a snack.
Yeah, yeah, you're just kind of eating around
like
it.
Like eating a drumstick, but your finger's the stick.
Yeah.
There's a donut. Have you been to that donut place like down the road there?
The last time I did a podcast here with Juvenalia, they had a selection of donut treats.
I didn't know with your dietary problems that you'd be able to have donuts. Not problems, but
I can
have goat's milk.
I can eat it. I can eat a lot of things. I just probably shouldn't.
Right. What's goat's milk like? Right.
Goat's milk is something that you have to really get used to. But once you do, like everything, like if it does taste nice in the end. I like goats. I like goats. Goat's cheese. It's gorgeous.
I love goat's cheese.
Oh man, goat's cheese is gorgeous.
Beetroot. You know, maybe sorry, I didn't mean to mention like your dietary problems.
Oh no, it's grand because I'm going to touch on that in the show. My little pooing disease.
I thought you were going to apologize for mentioning
dietary problems too.
Beetroots. Yeah,
my show's about
body dysmorphia and eating
disorders.
Oh
yeah.
Tell us about that, Davey. That must be a barrel of laughs.
Yeah, it's great crack. I'm terrified. Doing in Edinburgh because I never talk about it with anyone. Ever. So doing it in Edinburgh's like, oh, it's grand. I'm talking about it, but no one here knows me.
Yeah.
And my dad came to see me at the show in Edinburgh.
Yeah.
It was the first time.
Did he know?
Nope.
Did he know you'd body dysmorphia?
Nope.
Wow.
So that was not a fun show to do.
Wow.
Really?
So he was just there in the audience with his new lady friend.
You a child of a broken home too?
Yeah, more of like a 20-year-old of a broken home.
High five.
Yeah.
High five. When
I was 20. My
they
sister
split
was,
up
yeah,
when you were 20.
I think my mum was like, oh, well, Aoife's 18. You're both adults now.
Whoa.
Yeah. Mum told me really casually. I'd just done a gig in Calvin in the Gonzo Theatre and hosted it. Aidan Green was on and Fred Cook. And it was really good. And mum would come see me. And then we were just sitting in the sitting room that night. And then I was like, oh, I'm going to go up to bed. And mum was like, oh, you just, you know, I've asked your father for divorce. And I was like, oh, well, good night. Like, I wonder if I'd just sat there for longer. Yeah. Which you're just like, I'm going to have to sit here until David goes to bed so I can break this news just before. I was like, cool, okay. Yeah. I mean, it's fine with it.
I find it weird being so like an adult in your 20s. Talking to your parents about adult things that you share, like, because my parents separated when I was doing like the junior cert or something like that, and my mum will drop in like casual things like we're mates, do you know what I mean? And I'm like, I'm your child, I don't need to know this type of stuff.
You and her are mates, or you and
me and her are mates? We've always been kind of really matey, and it's always me that's always felt like I've had to put the boundary of I'm your child type thing.
She was like a cool younger mum.
She was. And my dad's lovely, but he did not take the divorce well. Like, he did not. And so we would have, and like, you know, he's an Englishman. He's like trying to have his feelings out, but he does it in the most, like, you know, he'd be like, oh, you know,
fucking divorce me, mate.
Yeah.
It's like divorce the voice you'd have before divorce you can't put a wall.
I am the BBC. Divorce me. But I look back at stuff now and I find it really funny and it kind of interesting, kind of like, you know, when you're 18 or when you're 20 and you're having these conversations with your parents, whatever, they're like, now this is the stuff I like to talk about.
Yeah.
We've got the promotional stuff out of the way. Let's get into pain. I'm learning so much more about you on this podcast than I ever did chatting to you normally. Like, you don't get to chat on the stairs though of a comedy club and go, well, my parents are split divorce. Up, you know?
Yeah, I think my parents were going to have a divorce when I was younger. Whoa. And I had seen so many like American films and TV shows that I was like, no, they can't get a divorce because if they do, there's going to be a parent trap.
They're
going to take like two of us someplace and the other two the other place, and I don't know who I want to live with just yet.
I remember
being very dramatic. Like, my parents were just like having a fight and said it kind of off the cuff, like, that's it, we're done or something. And I was like, no, you can't get a divorce. Do you hate us that much? And like, was really, really, really dramatic. And then I think they stayed together for kids, and now they cohabit.
That's beautiful.
When my folks are very much
I know they do. They get on very well. I think they get on more now since I've moved out.
Really?
I think because, you know, the way,
so
when
you were the problem, is that
when I was living there, they'd be having like little minor tiffs or whatever, but they'd always be like, can you hear him? Can you hear the shite he's coming out with? Or like,
they'd be like,
they could bounce off
like,
you.
Yeah, they bounce off me, and I just like, no, I don't want to. I'm not taking sides, guys.
But as a child of a divorced parents, I always felt like I was some sort of like kingmaker in a way.
Kingmaker.
Like
what does that mean?
Like dad or mum would be having a row, and go, can you believe this? It's this situation, and then whoever I side with, they're right.
Yeah.
I'd be like, so I felt like that, or Christmases. How was your Christmases after the divorce?
The first two, dad came to our like the home place, I suppose, and it was fine. Mm-hmm. It was all right. A lot of less tension than previous, than every other Christmas, but still not a huge amount of talking.
Yeah.
And then the last few, we've been going over to Dundalk to my aunt's house, me and mum and my sister. So, and then dad will go to family he has in Cavan. So it's been fine. And I usually go to dad's on Stephen's Day.
Cool. Well, my dad lives in England, so I always have to like make a big choice about where I'm going each Christmas.
Yeah.
So it's like, and I keep forgetting. Like, I keep trying to balance it out and go, I went there last year or whatever.
Right, where'd you go? You're just gone.
I mean, for the past two years, I think I've been at my mother's house in Ireland because of work and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I get about 3 days off and then I'm working, I'm doing some pissy bit or whatever. Mm. Pissy bit. Self-employed persons. You know, doing some old shite. I'd rather miss out on my dad's Christmas to do a bit on News Talk. Sometimes I feel so bad over that.
Well,
though,
you have like George Hook as a surrogate.
I know. Yeah. I know. It's so odd.
It's okay, Dad. I spent the Christmas with George, so it's pretty much the same.
Well, he's my next interview.
And tell me, Alison, which one of your parents do you love the most? I used to love my mammy. I have to say, I used to love my mammy.
Bring me the
Nothing like a father's love as well.
That's not a great act. That's not a great impression. But he always goes after it.
Kira, you couldn't be. You can't be serious, Kira.
I like him.
Does everyone have like one of those in their back pockets? Like,
I've never done an impression before. It was the first.
I love it. I
just really like when he disagrees with Kira Kelly. It's my favorite.
I'd love it if he did like voiceovers for stuff. I think he'd be great.
Oh,
like,
he would. He'd be a great character in a video game.
4G.
I hate when like McGarren does voiceover because I'm always like, oh, it's Kevin. Like, I don't like when, or it's McKenna. If it was George Hook doing like car ads, it'd be just weird. It'd feel like a sketch.
We were totally talking about that, about voiceovers and stuff, and that you hear a lot of comedians like in ad breaks now. And
like, oh, there's Tara.
Yeah. Or I love, one of my favourite things to do is sit down with my family on a TV and go, I know him.
Oh my God, that's always I know him. Fun. Yeah.
He's sound. Yeah.
My mom always does that as well. She's like, do you know him? For everyone who like is, I might have met once or like told her I might have once, she go, there's your friend, Andrea. Whenever she sees them on the telly, oh, Andrea, there's your friend. I remember I got a picture with Gabriel Byrne years ago, and I was really excited about it, and it was my profile picture for ages because I just thought he was a lovely man.
Yeah.
And he was really sound. And then he was on The Late Late Show years later, and my mom texts me and was like, turn on RT, your friend is on. I was like, who's on The Late Late Show? Which one of my friends has made it to The Late Late Show? It's fucking Gabriel Byrne. All right. No, ma'am. He's not. He's no friend of mine. I wish.
But if you were on The Late Late Show, what would you talk about? I feel I won't get on The Late Late Show unless I have a disease. What would I talk about?
What's Philip Badger Hayes on? Talking about sausages or something?
I would... Yeah, I don't know. Do you know what? That's a silly question.
Hopefully there's a murder in my town.
Swords.
Soon enough, and then I'll be talking
I have an unbelievable
that.
Murder story that I never tell anyone. It's pretty good. I told it on stage once at a gig in UCD with Charlotte that was doing as well. And I was only doing comedy like 6 months. So I had no notion of like what should be, like sort of the demarcation of what should and shouldn't be talked about on stage or
boundaries,
even how to talk about stuff.
Yeah.
How much world building do you want?
I want it all.
Right, because I feel like this is something I should just talk about because it's gross. So in 2008, I was living in Ringsend with some friends in this terrace house down opposite the Shelburne Dog Park, one of those red brick places. And we moved in, me and my friend Niamh Hanley and a few others, and me and Niamh rocked up to the house the first day. We weren't moving in that day, we just got the keys, so we were like looking around it kind of thing. Next, all of a sudden, this woman storms in the front door, asking, "Who are you?" And we're like, "Oh, we're the new tenants." She's like, "I'm the landlady," and then hands us a biscuit tin full of remote controls, being like, "Here's two batteries. Go find out which of these remotes work on what tellies," because there was little 14-inch Grundigs in every room. So we had to go around flicking on. It was a granny flat at the back that you could get through the side of the house or go through the kitchen through the backyard. She's like, "I'm doing a meter reading. I don't know what meter is what. Go into the apartment, turn on all of the electricity, and we'll see which one." Goes, starts speeding up, so we're like, all right, cool. So she was insane. A woman called Karen Walsh, she's insane. And
yeah, name her there, put the two names in.
The house was a mess. Like, we ran out of hot water for like a month one time, and it was just a shambolic spot. And we used to joke about how intense it was. Like, I don't want to shame how someone looks, but she looked like the makeup shotgun from The Simpsons. Like, that looked like she applied it, you know.
You have it set to whore.
Yeah, like, she just like, boom. So
how old is she?
Early 40s. 42.
Okay. Oh, right. That's 42. Very young, she making that makeup mistake.
Yeah, she's 42. She was a pharmacist. I don't know why I said was. She still is a pharmacist. Place in town. She's like, oh, I'm from Galway, but I live in Newry.
There's a lot of world building. You could kill this woman if you wanted to.
I mean, you haven't got to the juicy part.
Oh my God!
So, we used to joke about how intense this lady was, and she was mental. Then Christmas that year, 2008, Christmas 2008, I was in Calvin up in my attic playing my PlayStation. Next thing I hear Mum yell. I don't tell the story that often, so I forgot a detail.
Go on.
2 days previous to this, I was in Dundalk, my grandparents' house where Mum grew up. And on the news, there was a being like, oh, the body of an old woman was found on Christmas Day in Newry, and it showed the house. And Dundalk and Newry would be very close, and if you're from Dundalk, everyone go, you go to Newry for shopping and you know, Stirling and all that stuff. So we knew the house was on the hill into Newry. So we're like, oh, shit, that's that house. Weird. That's unfortunate. Just a murder on the TV, but we just happened to know the house. So that was the sort. Back in Cavan a few days later, in the attic playing PlayStation, next thing, Mum calls me. I'm like, yeah, what's up? She's like, what was your landlady's name? I'm like, Karen Walsh. And Mum's like, is this her? Like, fucking page 7 of the Independent. My landlady had been forced into handcuffs over the face into a car.
Oh my God.
She lived in Newry for the weekend. So I started laughing. I almost fell out of that. I started laughing because I didn't know how to process it. It was like Dublin socialite arrested on murder charge.
Oh my God.
So it's Dublin socialite arrested. Wait.
She was like a thing around town.
Your landlady?
Yeah, was arrested for this murder.
Oh my God.
All right. What had happened was she had this house in Newry that she lived in the weekends, and they went up to him for Christmas.
Yeah.
Christmas Eve, the old lady's like, hey, you want to come in? And I've got a present for your 3-year-old son.
Yeah.
And Karen also was like, okay. And then rocked up with a bottle of vodka. I was just drinking vodka straight. Something happened.
For the present.
The old lady was like, do you mind leaving? You're quite drunk. And, you know, my landlady, and my former landlady, took a notion that this was offensive and fucking clattered her with a crucifix.
to the point that
bet her to death with a crucifix. Bet this 88-year-old woman who the Bishop of Liverpool flew over to say the funeral. So she's like top-tier old lady, like big clergy are flying over just to say the funeral. Knocks her around the place with a crucifix to the point that in the news report they're like, oh, the thorns on Jesus' crown caused puncture marks. Like, right?
Gosh.
Gets worse. So,
where was the kid? Wasn't there a kid
next
there?
Door? Oh, next door.
Fucking hell.
Your one is so drunk, she then gets as far as like the wall, the front garden wall, and that's where she's like arrested. She falls asleep on the garden wall.
Oh, God.
Oh, no. Imagine falling asleep after doing a murder.
Right?
At the murder
and
scene.
And waking up hungover.
Davey.
Did you get your deposit back?
We didn't move out.
Oh, cool.
We didn't know what to do. We were... So she gets arrested.
I wouldn't pay her any rent, you know?
I think we should have.
You could get away with that.
Probably.
Fucking hell.
If you went to the PTRB, you'd be like...
Yeah.
I mean, she's not strictly violated any of our tenants' agreement, but...
Is she in prison?
She's in prison now, yeah. But she got out on bail for a little bit and moved...
She got out...
You ready for this? She got out on bail. We didn't realize this.
Were you still living there?
Yeah. Mum texted me. Like, she got out on bail. Mum found out on teletext. That was where this was. Just to give it a bit of framing. Our electricity went. So we were like, fuck this. And we went up to the shop to get credit to call the landlord to give out. Like your man, Durkin. And we saw the light in the granny flat on. And we were like, well, they've got power. Let's knock into our new neighbors. And we knocked in. And it's fucking Durkin opens the door.
No.
And next thing, Richard, who's at the door? They're after waking the baby. Fucking murder's moved in next door. So then we lived 3 months with
Davey.
This murderer. Yeah, living next to us. And like our back garden was the space between us now. It was tiny. And my bedroom window looked into her bedroom window.
Davey!
It was one night we heard somebody downstairs. And our back door, it wouldn't lock. We couldn't lock the door. So after coming through the back garden. She's in. So it was me, two mates, Rory and Connor. And we went downstairs. I'm like, fucking, there was nobody there. We had a crowbar because the front door used to jam, so we kept a crowbar on hand just to be able to open it. So we were all standing there. I was like, okay, I'm going to reef open the back door. Rory, you've got the crowbar. We're going to just confront whoever has been coming in and out. One of the girls had managed to lock the door that week without telling us. So I ended up reefing the door, but it just shook in the frame. And the person in the garden spins around. It was just her out having a smoke. But the way the sound was in the house, it sounded like she was in. So we all run back up to my room and we're all just talking about how insane she was. But then we're like, wait, we could hear her perfectly. She can definitely hear us shitting on her. My friend Niamh.
What's her name again? I want to Google.
Karen Walsh. Caught her looking in the post box of our door one time. We met her in Spar next to Google.
You know, my God.
And that we were getting sandwiches and she was next to us in the deli counter and she didn't recognize us as her housemates. She was with the kid also. They didn't...
Yeah.
This is what it says here. Karen Walsh, entrepreneur, socialite, mother, murderer.
Yeah, what? That's the LinkedIn, is it?
This is...
I ended up knocking the kid in his arse because he walked behind me.
Yeah. Crucifix. I got my sandwich in bail. Oh my God, they call her the crucifix killer.
Do you know... Now, this... Yeah. So fucking she then gets rearrested because they reckon she was a flight risk.
Yeah.
She used to brag to a jailmate, like before she was like processed, whatever, that she was able to get a passport. She's like, I can get a fake passport. And then one of her Botox checks bounced because she'd been getting Botox and she was 28. And the plastic surgeon then contacted the police. I'm like, hey, her plastic surgery is bouncing, and also she's inquiring about more things. So they put that together with I can get a new passport bragging and locked her up. They were like, oh, put her back in jail. Because you know, you get out on bail before you're charged or processed.
That's where they are, Alison.
Oh my gosh.
And do you want to know?
And that's the woman. That's the lovely woman she murdered.
That's cheap. Do you know, I really hate, and not as that I sounds like shoot, I really love old people.
Hmm. Like they're mostly sound.
More so than children. Like I get on that just nothing to do with
Do you know Georgia Street?
Yeah.
You know the pharmacy on Georgia Street? Not the one next to the Dunns, but the one that was like up near Laser.
Yes, next I do. The 16 bus stop. Is it in the corner?
No. It's, do you know where Flyfit is and the Dragon? You know where the Dragon was?
Yeah.
Opposite
across
there.
The road. Yeah.
Where like CEX is now. Like there's a, or it's the Good Food Co. Do you know where the Good Food Store is? That used to be a pharmacy.
Right.
And that was her pharmacy. So then that closed. That's why that closed down.
Right.
Because she did murder.
I had to do a, this is mad. I had to do, sure, we might as well just talk about murders that we've been by. I had to do a project for college, and it was like a law module of my media higher diploma in media, and they had a law module, and we had to go to the forecourts for the day. That was our homework. So I went to the forecourts, and I went into this courtroom because the judge was called Barry White, and I was like,
of course,
whoa,
that's the one you'd go.
So I went in and I just sat down. And I sat down in the public gallery, and there's loads of like older ladies with tea and sandwiches, and just they were watching it. And the court was packed. And I was like, oh, this must be cool. Watching it away anyway. And like, I didn't have an idea what was happening because they were just talking about different case files and all this, and there was no actual like this happened or whatever.
Yeah.
They were summoning up. I think they were getting sentenced that day, so there was not much like evidence to be given. It was a sentencing. So I went to the toilet anyway, and there was a ban guard in the toilet, and she was guarding the door, and I was like, oh, what's that about? So I went for a tinkle anyway, and I could hear the other person tinkling beside me. Then I went out and I washed my hands, and I looked, and it was she was called Lion Eyes. In the Sunday World.
Oh my God.
Do you know, have you heard of Lion Eyes?
No.
Right, I'll look this up.
Lion like the animal or lying?
Like the song, The Eagles.
Oh,
because
right.
The whole thing is like, she never murdered anyone. What she did was
she just had lion eyes.
She did. So she named herself after that song.
She named herself that?
Yeah, in this like forum. I think there's a massive thing about, like, you're from Cavan.
Yeah.
I'm from Westmeath and you're from Swords. So I don't know about what? Swords. But Swords is very, like, from what I gather, it's suburban, isn't it? Like, it's like a town.
We've had a few murders, though.
We've had a drive-by in Ballymore.
What?
Yeah, and it happened last year. Like, just, it was some sort of, it was a gang-related thing.
Yeah.
It was.
I was interviewed for murder investigation when I was 16.
Were you? Why?
A woman stabbed in the house, housing estate opposite me. By her ex-boyfriend's best friend, because she testified against the ex.
Oh my gosh.
And so we called the door and stabbed her, and she died in the doorstep.
Like, oh my gosh.
A few houses down from me. But it was just
like, this is Cavan.
Cavan, yeah. A few houses. So then they were trying to find the weapon, and they emptied all of the bins in Cavan, and they found like 35 knives that people had just panicked and ditched in bins throughout.
For that day?
Yeah, like over like, yeah.
Get rid of these knives.
Yeah. Once the news that someone had been stabbed, people started ditching their knives.
Because I found a really long knife in my bin in Dublin, and I called the guards because I was like,
that's a good thing to do.
Yeah, because I thought why would it be in my bin? Mm. And it was like a really, really long, it was a kebab, it was one of those kebab cutting knives.
Did you touch it?
No. Yeah. I just opened up the thing and I went, right, and I called the guards. But I didn't do the emergency line, I did the, like, you know.
Call the station.
Hello, and I always call the guards with loads of stuff. Like, there was a lad wielding a knife in Temple Bar having a fight. Like, he was obviously having a confrontation with this one lad. The one lad was way bigger than him.
Mm.
Like, I think it was over drugs or something. He was just a small, skinny lad, and he took out. And when he was punching at your man, he hit a pole, and I could hear metal off metal. And he was full on swinging. And I was like, oh, that's a knife. So I called the guards and I was like, man has a knife in Temple Bar. Like, he was never going to hurt me or hurt anyone else, but he was having a row with this lad. And I was like, I can't stand there while that happens. Like, I'm always, like, I'll always call the guards. Or if there's that.
I call the ambulance like a demon.
Yeah. Or if there's drunk people as well as that. Like, and they'll make the poor ambulance service lads will make me wait there for about 10 minutes. And like, especially because, like, in central Dublin, they get very, like, the mates will get very belligerent if you call an ambulance and stuff.
She's crying, she needs to go home to bed.
Yeah, and you're like, no, that person's not responding.
Bleeding out their head.
Yeah. That person's not responding. So, I can't believe we got into this, because I like this conversation. But, like, it's so hard to talk about, like, murders and stuff, because it's so sensational. And then everyone, like, you know, newspapers are built off it and stuff.
Yeah.
And I always just, I keep remembering there's a person, and it's so, I could never imagine someone killing me. That's like, do you know?
Yeah.
I just like, I could never, and that person, like, that was your landlady, you never look at her and go, oh, she's capable of murder. Like, she's
no, we used to joke about her being intense and insane. But like, never.
Do you remember that murder in the Knoll, which is near Swords? And the guy, the husband who did it, he appeared on the Late Late Show with the mother-in-law.
Yeah. Well,
The Knoll is, like, not far from my house at all.
Yeah.
And so that was, like, kind of like a local murder. And but when, after that murder happened, and after it was found out that he was the bad lad who did it, that house went up for sale and my parents went to view it.
No, couldn't.
For a crack?
Well, no, they said, because they were thinking of moving, and like obviously that had lowered the price.
It's a very kind of like rural thing. It's such a shame.
I don't know if you're the same, maybe growing up in rural Ireland, but murders were things that happened in Dublin.
Yeah, totally. Like, murders were things that happened in Dublin. Like, even, like, I think a lad got bet to death in Athlone, near the bridge in Athlone. And I was like, what? This is not, not possible.
A case at home where some lads were mugging an old man and he had a heart attack and he died. And that
in
was
Cavan.
Like, and that was like the first thing I remember at home.
How could you mug in Cavan? I can't understand how someone
he had a
could,
gang problem like, for this, a while.
He had a gang problem in Cavan.
Then the rack came down and sorted it out. I wish I was joking. A thing called the 32 County Sovereignty Movement someone wrote to them asking them to come down. So they sent an open letter to the newspaper saying, look, there's some antisocial behaviour in Cavan, so we're coming down to put the schlaps on some lads.
Fair play
to
them.
The RA
will
fix it.
Sometimes the RA know what to do, don't they?
So then they started shooting machine guns or like AKs into the sky outside the sort of dodge around a town one day outside a bunch of pubs.
Oh my God.
And then everyone came out of the pubs, and then they started handing out leaflets on antisocial behaviour.
Wow.
But how they decided to get everyone out was shooting semi-automatic weaponry into the air.
That's brilliant.
That's Cavan. I mean, oh
this
my
is
gosh.
Cavan.
Cavan's insane, like, yeah.
But I've always kind of been jealous of you and Kevin McGahern and just people from Cavan, because you seem to have like a real, and like you're,
there's a good buzz at the moment.
You're practically married into Cavan, Andrea.
Honorary Cavan.
Honorary Cavan, but it seems like the Gonzo Theatre and it seems and like all, a really nice community down there. Mm. Up there, in
up
fact.
Up there, it is, yeah.
Yeah. But why is Cavan, like, I would never, no one would shoot AK-47s up this guy in Westmead. Why Cavan?
I mean, it was the 32 CSM came down.
Yeah.
They were blow-ins.
Ah, were they?
Yeah. I don't know. I wasn't there.
Yeah.
We're all balaclavaed up, I presume.
Yeah.
I think they were just in their day clothes.
I have a balaclava.
That's mad. Did I?
So you're saying it was you? You're just dropping that in?
Do you know what? Pork got me a balaclava for Christmas 2 years ago for a laugh.
Do you wear it?
I think I wore it once.
How big is it? Is it like an eye?
Oh, it's a full balaclava.
Like I made one. I got my mum to make one as a kid. I got a beanie just so I could pull it down.
Just
the holes out.
This is Cavan.
How do you feel about the rat?
My uncle was kidnapped by them in the 80s, but I've also had family members who were in it, so it's a bit of a thing.
Everyone's family has connections to the rat.
I think
not like, I don't know.
No, it's like someone might,
at some stage,
dad's cousin
somebody
married.
Somebody in the family was in the rat.
Yeah.
No, I have that.
You know,
too.
That's
yeah,
sort of
yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's never my uncle.
What happened to your uncle?
My uncle was he's a vet. He works at the EU.
And they were like, "Yeah, we hate animals."
So his mum's brother's at Dundalk, and there's a part of Armagh that dips down between Louth and Monaghan called Bandit Country, sort of across McGlen.
Yeah.
Mm. So, Jim, my uncle, was just driving to a farm to do check up on some animals, or whatever, and they just were like, "Just there was two lads, guns, the works. Here, up, out of the car." Into the back of this van. In the back of the van were the two lads who'd been driving the van. They just drove them around for a couple of hours and then left them inside of the road somewhere else.
Were they looking for ransom or were they just taking the car?
They were taking the car.
All right. Then
the car was found months later with a bunch of burnt out, but a bunch of reg plates in the back. And they're like, oh, these are all the reg plates that have been robbing those petrol stations.
Right.
So
okay.
Right, okay.
So they effectively, I say kidnapped, they just took him for a bit of a spin. Gave him a half day.
So they kidnapped him so to make sure he wouldn't follow up with the police or anything like
immediately,
that.
Immediately, I suppose, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's mad. That's a...
Harmless lads, though. In this instance.
Yeah. In that instance. It's mad because you just forget that this country has been affected by terrorism.
Yeah, and it's weird growing up on the border because you do have people who are connected to it. I told that to my friend one time, a friend from Monaghan, and he's like, where was this? I'm like, oh, sort of... you know, a bit of Armagh where it dips in. He's like, I'm not joking, but that's probably my dad. Like,
Whoa.
Just said so casually.
Yeah, Monaghan and Cavan, they're just...
Yeah, there's the spots of Cavan near Fermanagh.
Yeah.
And Monaghan in particular, there's a lot of... Yeah. A
lot of joyriding and stuff going on there.
Jeez.
I went to Loch Glass, which is near Monaghan, but on the Northern Irish side. And... I just remember the kids there were like really, really tough. And like even there's this like 12-year-old kid. I was babysitting my cousins, and my oldest cousin that was there was about 13 and I was about 16. And she's gorgeous. And all the lads kept knocking on the door. Sinead coming out. And one of them gave me cheek and I was like, Sinead's never coming out. And I kept her in. Like, you know, I was like, no, Sinead, you're not allowed out. Just to annoy them. And they stole my littler cousin's bike, like a little Barbie with stabilizers. And he was about 15, this lad. And he had a Benson in his mouth. He's just cycling this small pink car. But I looked at him and I was like, you are cool.
I'm having an authority moment bike. Here, but I also wish you'd like me. Like,
yeah. It was totally like, but I can't... What about swords then? Is there anything kind of like, not cavity, I was going to ask, what's the most interesting thing about swords?
You've got a castle.
We've got a castle that's being done up at the minute. I'd love if it was turned into a theatre, because we don't have any theatres in Swords. That's our big ball down.
Nice 100-seater black box.
Yeah, that'd be class.
How big is Swords? It's out near the airport, isn't it?
Oh, like, I remember when I was in school, it was... 20,000.
Yeah.
But now it has to be like, it might have even tripled in size because there's loads of like, you know, those extra Celtic Tiger estates.
Yeah.
The big boom, we call them the Lego houses. It's just loads of these like little tiny kind of townhouses. Big, big estates built behind my house. Mental.
They sound really pretty.
Yeah, no, they're grand. I don't think they're that, I honestly don't think they're that well built because my brother, when he came home from America for a visit, he was home for a summer, and him and his wife and his he had one daughter at the time, and they rented one of these like townhouses thinking it'd be grand. They said no, they're not nice at all.
Some of them were just built real quick.
Yeah, built real quick, and they're built for like a couple with definitely no children. One person or two people does not.
There was apartments built in Dundrum that were that sort of like, oh, it's the Celtic Tiger, knock up these apartments. And then those people paid for them and bought them. And we're like, oh, well, that's us invested forever. And then it came out, they're like, oh, no flame retardant stuff was used in the building of these. So everybody out. We've got to scrap these apartments. Sorry about
buying. Oh, yeah, what's that area called?
There was huge protests about that.
And pyrite as well is another thing.
Yeah.
That's the crazy thing. Pyrite is like... it comes from the quarry. Like, it's a problem with the building materials from the quarry, I think, itself. Mm-hmm. And, like, the houses will eventually, like, they're not fit crumble. For living. Yeah, they're not fit for living. They get big cracks in the walls already and stuff. And so the builders, you know, they're either bankrupt. A load of them are bankrupt from the recession itself.
So the people are just kind of left with
shit.
Yeah, yeah, and a mortgage. Shit and a mortgage. That's, you know, it's horrible. It's horrible. I feel we've meandered down a really lonesome road, whether it be financial worries or actual murders.
If you're good though.
Yeah, are you looking forward to that in the fridge?
Does that show where your one kicks the shite out of a lad?
Which one is that? The over-the-top wrestling?
No, it's a kickboxing thing.
Really?
There's some improvised kickboxing choreograph. I don't know. But it's full contact dancing.
Oh.
I don't really know what it is.
Nice.
It's Portuguese as well. I heard enough words in a crowd that I'm like...
There's a weird like dance kind of experience thing that looks brilliant.
The
Can't remember what it's called, but it looks mental.
Hot Brown Honey that I really want to see.
Oh, no, that's not the one I was talking about.
There's so much. There's
Kraken.
Kraken, yeah. Is that the thing that was in Edinburgh last year?
Everyone was losing their shit. No, last year was Nautilus, but he was doing Kraken as well.
Right, right, right.
Because Kraken was a show from 2 years ago.
Yeah,
so that's coming. That's
coming. Heidi O'Loughlin as well is doing fan fiction. She's a New Zealand comedian.
She's doing core comedy as well, isn't she?
Yeah. Like, actually, you should come up with some fan fiction and get in contact with her and stuff. And
there's fan fiction about me and Ryan online.
Oh my god!
I'd be too uncomfortable to read it, Davey.
Davey, I don't know. Like, this is so. I have to get you on for proper. I know you do. I know you do. That's mad. Okay, tell me about that. So Davey is with. Do you want to? Yeah,
I have to bounce.
Oh, cool.
Oh god, so, yeah, I didn't realize the time. Sorry.
No.
Take care.
Yeah.
Podcast Nation.
And what time's your show at again, Andrea?
18:45
in the International Bar. I've seen it in Whelan's and I thought it was class. We have enough time to talk about this. So, Davey, you work for Facts.
Yeah. Yeah, work for it. But yeah, sure.
Yeah. Because, like, I did stuff for Facts when they first started out. Yeah. You did too.
Yeah.
And I kind of went off it because I didn't like the comments about my personal appearance. Yeah. But you've continued on with Facts now. And it's weird walking around with you in town because loads of people will walk up and go, hey, you're the Facts lad.
It's really weird.
What's that like for you?
It's really, yeah. Edinburgh, it was great for Edinburgh because I had people in my show every day that knew me from YouTube. And every day since I got back, people have said, like, come up to them in the street and stuff. Me and George met a guy earlier on even, George Fox. The weirdest, because usually it's like, oh, you're the guy from Facts, or I follow you on YouTube. At Electric Picnic, literally someone was like, Davey Reilly, and it's the first time anyone's sort of know me by name. And
wow,
that was cool. It is like, it's still really weird.
What'd you do at Electric Picnic? Did you do the Comedy Caravan?
Yeah,
I liked it.
Do you want to see my video?
I do.
Oh my god, so you might appreciate this
at home. Oh yeah,
you might
I will.
Appreciate what I did.
I'll tell you, for the listeners at home, there's like two separate comedy things. There's a comedy tent where people could go in and sit down. Electric Picnic is a big festival in the middle of Ireland, and it's a lovely arts and music festival. And there was another option called the Comedy Caravan, run by the lovely Gráinne McKeever, who's fantastic at what she does. But like, you're at the side of a caravan which was basically to stop people passing you by to watch you do comedy.
Yeah.
So it was odd. It was odd to do, but I enjoyed it.
Because that caravan was at Longitude and it was lovely.
Oh, I loved it so much. So do you know why that was? Because it was in a separate area.
Out of the way. It wasn't a thoroughfare.
It wasn't through a thoroughfare. And as well as that, it was separate from the main area. And I heard a load of people, anytime I asked people, like, why are you up here at the Comedy Caravan when Major Lazer were on or whatever? They would say, you know, I'm over 25 and I just feel so old in the main area. And in here, where the Comedy Caravan is, or where the burlesque stuff. Yeah, all the sound people are hanging out. It was lovely. So tell me about this.
So all weekend, I was in a bit of a mood and I wasn't like looking forward to doing it. So it was a bit sort of like, oh, I don't want to do this. And it was raining. So I was like, nobody's going to want to stop. And
yeah.
So I just took this notion to read Morrissey's Wikipedia page. So I went on and was like, hey, my name is Davey Reilly. None of you know who I am though, right? And everyone was like, yeah, we don't know who you are. I was like, well, I'll read you my Wikipedia page.
Amazing.
So I read the first two paragraphs of Morrissey's Wikipedia page with my name and date of birth filled in.
So you're like, so Davey Reilly, it's 22nd of May 1959, yeah.
Yeah, I'm 22nd of June.
Ah.
I'm one of my best friends, the 22nd of May.
I'm a big fan.
His middle name is Patrick. And my middle name is Patrick. So there was enough, and he was from like Davey Home or something.
Davey Home, and his father's name is Peter, and his mother's name is Elizabeth.
Yeah,
I'm not looking at Wikipedia. No. This is my memory.
But so I was sort of reading this out, and stopped changing the dates.
Okay,
and then it gets to the point where it's like, in like 1982, along with Johnny Marr, Davey Reilly formed the Smiths.
Amazing.
And I read like two lines more after that, just to make sure people understood what the. I thought it was pretty funny. Some people enjoyed it.
Yeah.
But then some people didn't enjoy it.
Is this what's happening?
And this is this video. Because Laura Byrne was filming me.
Oh, Davey. Let's see. For people at home. Will I put it up to the mic? So there's a man in a hood with no sleeves who looks like he's going to kill you.
Like that video sums up my gig. Just me trying to pretend I'm Marcy.
Oh my
god. As a man in wellies, gas shorts and a sleeveless hoodie stares at me with all the intention if he'd walked in on me robbing his house.
I'll kill you.
And that was like minute 2 of 20.
So what's it like, what will you not do for facts? Like, is there anything you've been asked to do that you won't do?
I won't do any drinking stuff just because I don't drink.
Yeah.
No, I always find out. If I feel like something is not necessarily gratuitous. Yeah, if I feel like something is gratuitous or there's not another layer to it.
Yeah.
It's like the only one that, like, might say my mum didn't like me doing was the old waxing one that me, Ryan, and E-Man did.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I.
That was big, though.
Yeah, it got like 1.5 million views. But the reason I did it was because I think there's a hugely unfair expectation on women.
Yeah.
And I felt like, you know, fuck it. Men should try this. It's not something I've ever criticized anyone for. So I wasn't like, I need to go through this so I can have a valid opinion on it. But just more in a like... Because lots of comments were like, men are stupid. Why are men doing this? Men are becoming pussies these days. It was like, well, look, people expect women to do this. So guys couldn't be criticized for it. Like, you know, that's sort of.
And just for the listeners at home, I forgot to say, Facts is like a very popular YouTube site made in Ireland.
Yeah.
But it's very popular with Americans.
Americans in particular,
it?
Yeah.
And they have a stable now of people kind of together and stuff. But you've been there. From the off, practically.
Kinda, yeah.
So, what's been your favorite? Like, what's been your favorite?
I really like shooting guns, just because that was a thing I never got a chance to do before.
Nice.
And it was it was terrifying because it was really fun, which then itself was terrifying. You're like, oh no,
what have I become?
I can see why people like doing this.
Yeah.
And that was with Ryan and Laura Byrne. So like, I really like when I get to do the videos with people I'm close friends with, especially outside of Facts as well.
Yeah.
So they're quite good. I like doing them, and the people who watch them, the people who leave comments are, as you said, they leave quite mean comments. I used to hate the comments, but then one was so over the top that it weirdly negated everything.
Really?
So now I actually find the critical ones pretty funny.
Right.
Someone said that that faggot should go hang himself. A comment someone left about me.
Oh my god!
In a video where I said I didn't like Reese's Pieces. So I was like, okay, if someone's getting that angry because I didn't like fucking peanut butter chocolate,
yeah,
maybe it's like that was sort of that provided the sliding scale, the scale,
yeah,
or the curve by which everything was measured on. So
that's mad.
Yeah,
that's mad.
So I don't really. I find it quite funny now.
What do you enjoy watching on YouTube?
Oh, Hydraulic Press Channel is my favorite thing. Because the thing, I'm not even really into YouTube. But I watch some wrestling stuff or What Culture Wrestling. It's like the wrestling channel.
Mm.
But Hydraulic Press Channel is incredible. What it is it's so relaxing. It's a Finnish dude who owns like a metal workshop who just has a big hydraulic press that can crush up to like a ton of pressure. And he just crushes shit. That's it. That's all he does.
Oh my God.
So like some stuff explodes. He crushed a Finnish dictionary and it exploded because when paper's compressed it. But he's quite broken English. He's like, today on the hydraulic press channel, crashing. It's so good.
And crashing.
It's so funny.
That's brilliant.
They're really satisfying to watch. I don't know what it is. It's just like, the noise and then the crushing, you're like, ah, this is quite... Like every day after Edinburgh, every night I get in, I'd always put on a video of something getting crushed. It's like, ah, it could be worse. Like, could be that teddy bear that's had a ton of pressure squashing on it.
Because I felt with Edinburgh, like, so much pressure that I kind of, I would watch, like, I used to watch The Big Reunion, which is an ITV2 show that you can find on YouTube now.
It's the one where they're trying to get all the bands back together.
Bewitched, like, Blue.
Right.
Blue was fantastic because Blue witnessed September the 11th happening. Like, they saw the first plane crash.
What?
Or they saw the second plane
crash.
Where
were they?
They were in New York.
Obviously.
And they were at home, you know, watching the news. Watching the news. Like it's all.
I'd love if they were like, we watched it happen. Like, oh my God. Like, I'm just Sky News. Like,
we all watched that. But they watched it happen. And then for their press tour, for the rest of the time after, they were getting interviewed. They were talking. Like, every question would be about September 11th. Yeah. What was it like? And then Lee, who is the most mouthiest out of the bunch, he just went mad one day he went, you know what? Fuck those towers. Why don't we just talk about something else, something that matters, like the elephant's dying or something.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then headline, destroyed their career in the US. And it was just, but it was so interesting to watch. And also, I love pop music and I love mental health problems.
Yeah.
And it was so full of both. And I loved it so much.
The show in general?
Yeah.
They all went bankrupt. Every one of
members
Blue.
Of Blue.
I think Duncan was the last one.
I don't understand how much people get paid to be in bands, because I don't think they get paid enough, considering how busy they must have been.
Yeah.
You're spending your 20s getting up, going on a breakfast radio show. You know, I think they should be... I think they should do the Simon Cowell for slavery.
Yeah.
There must be some
because
employment
they don't, because
laws.
They don't write the songs. It's the writers tend to make the money. But they're still being trotted around and...
A1 wrote their songs.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Ben
and Paul.
Ben of the Curtains fame.
Ben and Paul. Oh, you know, it's so weird. They're in the second series. And
I like that it got recommissioned.
It did. Yeah. It got recommissioned. They had Eternal in the next one. And they had this thing called Fifth Story, which is like a band that's made for the big reunion. It's had Dane Bowers.
Yeah, I remember
Gareth Gates.
Them popping up on some stuff.
Yeah.
Post-show press tour.
Gosh, I love Dane Bowers so much. I love the idea of Dane Bowers more than Dane Bowers. Like, do you remember?
Just that someone like Dane Bowers can succeed? Is that what you mean? Like,
I think
there's hope for all of us?
Especially, like, there's a music video where he wears a denim cowboy hat, and I go, you go, Dane. You go.
Yeah, he didn't have to wear that. I'm sure people told him not to.
He didn't, but he went ahead anyway. He's a renegade. So tell me about your show, Dane.
Yeah, so it's about body dysmorphia and kind of how masculinity is dangerous.
Yeah.
Because you saw the first 20 minutes of it, I guess.
I did. I went with my granddad. And he had to get a bus. I put money in the bucket,
though. You did. It was too sweet of you. So it's sort of about how... Because I was chatting about this with someone yesterday about my issues that I have with the show. So I'm trying to not undermine the show.
Yeah.
While trying to promote it.
We all have issues with our show, though, and that's cool.
Yeah. In terms of, like, artistic honesty, be like, I feel like I should be more, not revealing necessarily, but...
It's hard being a comedian, though, and doing that, because sometimes, like, when I did the Hawaiian show, and talking about, like, pissing into a pint glass, your lowest point and stuff, sometimes I'd come off stage and I'd feel bad, and I'm like, why am I feeling bad? Oh, it's just because you've just relived the time where you've walked in on people robbing your house. Do you feel like that? Is that a thing?
The first... half of the run was exhausting because I was talking about these things for the first time. There's maybe four people I'd spoken to in the last year about body dysmorphia, and then I'd have like exes who knew I didn't like how I looked.
Yeah.
But it's been a lifelong thing, so it's never been spoken about. So then talking about how I felt during school and being in a boys' school and having these issues and having to repress them because I didn't feel like you could talk to them. So that's how I sort of talk about masculinity being dangerous, because I didn't know how to process any of these things.
Mm.
And I didn't feel like I could talk to anyone, because there's like, oh, men shouldn't cry, or men shouldn't feel weak, or any of these things. And I'm lucky that I got through that to a point where I now am dealing with it.
Yeah.
But there are so many people, there's countless people who have not been able to process these things and have maybe ended their life, or it, you know, gone off the rails, for want of a better phrase. And I think that is all as a result of masculinity promoting this culture of strength and encouraging, like putting on a brave face, mm-hmm. but in a far more aggressive sense.
It sounds like a very kind of rural man thing as well.
Yeah.
Like to put a brave face and
exactly,
stuff.
Exactly, yeah.
So do you think growing up in a rural area, kind of looking at stuff, feeling like, I presume, judging by the way you dress and stuff like that, that did you feel like an outsider in your village?
Yeah,
or how was
yeah,
it?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm from, luckily, I'm from Cavan Town, so I would be a townie, but still it's like 4,000 people, so it's not big by any stretch. Was liked a lot of like emo music, but no one else in my year did. So then I was friends with the guys who'd listen to more metal and punk. It was just like everyone who just, like all these guys who I would be chatty with now, but we wouldn't really be friends anymore because all we had in common was we'd liked different music to the majority.
Yeah, so you didn't like DJ Rankin.
Exactly, like Special D could
Special
stay.
D.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
I did have a kind of soft spot for Special D.
Bobby Joe. So, yeah, didn't feel comfortable at home. Like in, not at home in my house, but in terms of like in Calvin, didn't feel like I could chat to anyone about any of these things. I got diagnosed with ADD a few weeks ago.
And how did that come about?
I finally started talking to somebody about how my attention span has always been atrocious since I was a kid.
Yeah.
I did the test and they're like, you've had this your whole life.
That was never picked up in school.
I didn't tell anyone.
I just
seemed lazy because they're like, you're good in class, but you're not studying. I'm like, guess I'm not studying. And it was like, I was trying to study and I would spend hours studying, but I couldn't focus. So I'll talk about that a little in the show as well, because that was like the development before going away.
So is your show about processing a lot of stuff and kind of...
It's definitely helping me process stuff. I started talking about bits on Twitter and on Tumblr. And the nice thing about facts is that I do have a nice little following of fan base.
Mm.
And by talking about some of the stuff online, sometimes I'll do like little, like Curious Cat is the thing everyone's using now. You know, they like ask me questions. Mm-hmm. I used to do that on Tumblr a few months ago. Just if I was getting the bus back to Dublin from Calvin and it was like 8 at night. I was like, well, there's nothing to do. It's too dark to read or write or whatever, so I'll just take questions, whatever. And I ended up, not really thinking about it, mentioning the dysmorphia, which is something a doctor told me about years ago. And loads of people then were like, oh, I can relate to these things. Effectively, people were messaging me saying that describing a similar situation that I was in when I was a teenager. So I was like, okay, well, I should keep talking about these things because I do have a little bit of a public platform, or I have a degree of an audience.
Yeah.
And if I hopefully talk about these things, about how I felt weird or have issues with food or eating disorders, hopefully it'll help other people who might experience them but don't know how to verbalize it. And they'll be like, okay, I'm not the only one who feels like this. And it hopefully will help normalize things. That's kind of what the show is about. It's hard to do and it is helping me process some stuff and feeling less bad about and awkward about things, but it's still emotionally draining to do.
Yeah.
And I'm anxious doing it in Dublin because at least in Edinburgh there's the anonymity of where people who've known me 10 plus years are going to show up and be like, oh, weird.
But they're not, I promise. I still
have that thing because comedy obviously is still quite a lad's game. Like there's a real boys club attitude around it, so I'm still afraid of coming off stage sometime and people be like, you feel fat, faggot. Like, and that's what made the show real hard to write. I didn't finish writing it like 2 weeks in Edinburgh because I was nervous about testing any of it around comics. I felt like Edinburgh was like an artistic place that you could like, okay, everyone here is a direction that they're working their show towards. So at least here I can open up a bit more. And with that anonymity, at least other comics are over here doing their show. So no one's going to be like, hey, you feel fat. I'm like, yeah, well, your sister died. Like, you know, you couldn't. There was that thing. Not everyone's show, but a lot of people's show was about something that was
personal.
Yeah, so no one was going to be coming from like attacking or making fun of people. Whereas here, you're like, I don't want to rock, because I like the comedy scene here in Ireland. There's problems with it, but I think there's a lot of benefits as well to having a smaller scene. And I'm doing quite well, so I don't want to be too critical, but there's definitely a bit of a boys' school thing or boys' club.
Yeah.
Where that mentality of not opening up or being necessarily like honest is can be criticized.
Do you? That's really cool that you say that, because I would feel the same way. And I would feel like that's a problem for women. Mm. But like, it's cool that you're kind of talking about how masculinity can be toxic and stuff for men as well.
Yeah.
Could I ask you, like, how did you discover you had body dysmorphia? Or how did you even, like, when did this occur? How old were you when you first?
I always knew something was, like, I always thought I was massive. And I hated, like, PE, and I was bad at sport. And I always equated being, like, slow or bad at sport to being, like, large. And I was, like, lumpy is the word I always use, or misshapen. In my show, I describe, like, my skin doesn't fit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm just not sitting right. Like, I feel like I'm not sitting correctly in my skin. And I will often try writhe in bed to try to, like, as if I'm trying to maneuver my body in my...
In your skin?
Yeah.
So would it be like your bones and
like
stuff?
Like, I'm sort of like, I'll sort of try rolling my back and like as if the thing I use in my show to describe it is like when a duvet isn't sitting right in its cover.
Yeah, it's a great analogy.
So that's the easiest way I have to describe it. So I felt like that forever. And then when I was 18, I started seeing a doctor about depression because I was like, oh, this is a thing. Other people feel like this too. I'm not, so I was like, I should tell you about this. Then on and off for years, I was seeing doctors and therapists and shit. And talking about this, and slowly more and more of it came out because I was like, no, I'm just really sad, and was trying not to talk about. There's a thing about it that it can, I'm always afraid that being insecure about appearance will be misconstrued as vanity.
Yeah.
Like, people always just presume if someone's looking in a mirror, it's because they're vain.
Yeah.
I really like selfies. I think selfies are great because they help normalize what you look like to yourself. But they're also like a little reminder of like, okay, my hair's not looking as bad as I thought it was. You know, it's like, so I don't,
That's really
because
true.
Of that fear, because of that fear that people would be misconstruing having image issues and insecurities as me being vain.
Yeah.
I just didn't say anything.
Because I was going to ask you, because sometimes... I feel weird about asking you stuff about your body dysmorphia because I'm fat myself, right? So I feel like you might be scared I might be judging you or something by going, you're not fat, you don't know what fat is. Like, do you worry about that or anything?
Yeah, I definitely do. I definitely...
Well, I want you to say, don't worry about it at all. Like, I know people with addictions and... OCD and stuff that really affects them. Yeah. And I mean addictions to not alcohol, not drugs.
Yeah,
just
various
things. And, you know, you should not, this is stupid of me, I just want you to know, like, as a friend and shit, like, don't.
Oh, I appreciate that.
And I totally, like, it's a thing and everyone knows it's a thing, so don't.
Yeah.
It's the feel like sometimes you feel like people might not believe
that's a bad thing.
I know it's
because there is like a cognitive disconnect. Like, I can see what the labels on my clothes say. I can see what those sizes are.
Yeah, yeah.
But then I see myself in the mirror. I'm like, it doesn't match up. And I'd nearly rather believe that there's like a conspiracy from big clothing companies to trick me than actually accept that the labels are accurate and what I'm seeing in the mirror isn't. So I do feel like because of that, like, it's nearly, you know, sometimes it's the trouble between accepting like the logical part of your brain and the emotional part. And you're like, well, I know that this is the case, but emotionally I can't accept that. And that disconnect. So I do often feel like our audiences might not believe me because this is what I meant about the artistic honesty of the show.
Yeah.
Putting myself up on stage and inviting an audience to look at me for an hour.
Mm.
I feel it's something I need to address in the show because I don't want that to potentially undermine the message of the show. But I overthink everything, so.
Yeah, you're thinking then people are going, well, he's vain enough for us to come see him for an hour.
Yeah.
So I don't believe that he feels bad about himself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But like.
If he felt these way, he wouldn't be putting himself
in the
public view or.
That's your, like, I have that with my mind where it just says the most horrible things possible.
Yeah.
And you know you have to push. I mean, there's no choice now because you're doing the fringe.
Yeah.
So you just have to push past that thought and stuff. And I feel, this sounds like, since I've been truthful about stuff or since I feel like I've been saying my truth, that people are a lot more receptive and stuff. You're telling your truth. No one can take that away from you. Someone can be a prick, but you're helping so many other people. You got to think of the positives and stuff.
When I saw your show in MVPs, June or so, I still had so much on my show to write, but seeing your show and Sophie's show was a huge help in helping me feel less afraid to be open about stuff.
Yeah.
Like putting more of myself into my stand-up, because I like silly and I like absurd stuff.
Mm.
But I would write more towards that way because I'm afraid to write personal stuff. I'm like, no, I need to make sure everyone thinks I'm okay and look at this cool, nice guy. He's opposed to like,
he knows what he's doing.
Yeah, exactly. This guy's got his shit together.
Yeah. I'll listen to him. Yeah.
Rather than like, I've cried twice on the 46A today. Like that sort of thing. So seeing you and Sophie's show and dealing with the honesty in both really helped me to talk about stuff that pretty much how like the meat of the show, the stuff I had been putting off, now consists of most of the show, whereas at that point I had written all these like stupid filler bits.
Yeah.
I was like, it's cool, I'll just write these bits, and then I just need to talk about my body occasionally. And I felt like I was doing myself and I guess my art the service.
Do you think that's like our way, like the audience is our parents in a way, and we just want to tell them we're okay. We want to entertain you.
Yeah.
But ultimately, I find...
Don't worry about me.
Yeah. I find it hard to toe the line between people feeling sorry for me and going, oh, because that's not the reaction you want at a comedy show.
Yeah.
So it's tried to keep it funny and to be truthful.
Yeah.
Like sometimes, even when I do the getting robbed bit, the first time I got robbed, a man had a knife. And I omit that from the joke now.
Yeah.
Because as soon as someone hears, oh, he had a knife and he came up to me, they're like, oh, well, this is a threatening situation. Nothing can be funny at this. But if he just came up to me and I just don't mention he had a knife, then it's fine. It's one of those things.
The comic was on after me in Edinburgh.
Mm.
It was fine. We got on ground like in our brief interactions. He'd come into my show a few minutes early and it was always quite distracting.
Yeah.
And to see him pop up the back, because it made me feel like I was rushed. But he said to me one day after the show, he's like, audience coming on the show always seem to have nearly poignant reactions to it. But I whatever way he said it, because you have people coming over to me, maybe just one or two even, just being like, oh, I can relate, or some of that resonates.
Yeah.
But the way he said it was, it felt nearly critical, and it was unusual.
I think people...
I don't know if it was an envy thing, that his show isn't operating on that level, like that might not be a layer, or maybe he was hoping for something similar and he wasn't achieving it. I didn't watch your show, so I can't comment, but it just felt like a strange thing to, but again, I could be misreading or misconstruing his intentions there out of insecurity.
Yeah, but like I find if you pander to those people, you're just stifling yourself.
Yeah, fuck them.
Yeah, ain't gonna help you in any way.
Yeah,
but we're cool. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
I think I don't want to make you late and stuff.
No, that's all right.
Gee, I feel like we really had some proper chats towards
that was
the
good.
End.
Yeah.
And like, yeah. Here, give me a hug. Davey. Just going to close up. Yep. Davey Reilly is on from the 19th until...
24th
of September in the International... No, he's not. He's in the Stag's Head downstairs. Stag's Head downstairs. 19th until the 24th at 6:45 p.m. You should go check him out. Gerald Farrelly, fellow podcaster. He is on the week before.
Oh, yeah, I don't know what the date's the week before.
He's on the week before, but in the Stag's Head, and it'd be lovely. Thank you so much for listening to the Alison Spittle Show. I've been Alison Spittle. My guests today were Andrea Farrell and Davey Reilly, and they'll be on my show properly in front of an audience later on this year. But I just wanted to be honest with you lads, I'm doing the Cork Comedy Festival, George Hook, interviewing him on the 25th of September in the Cork Opera House. And I'm doing the Dublin Fringe Festival, 18th of September, in the project Arts Centre in Dublin, and that's on the 18th of September. I got Erin McGaffey and I got Carol Spain, and I'm getting a house band. There's going to be sketches, getting a projector. It's going to be absolutely class crack. So with those big shows coming up, I'd no time to do a show in front of a live audience, so we're doing a lovely little Tiger Dublin Fringe special. I really recommend, lads, if you're living in Dublin, please go to the Tiger Dublin Fringe. There's so much on. There's Riot with Panty and Emmett Kerwin and
Collapsing Horse are doing
Claps and Horse are doing something mad.
Yeah,
this festival is class, and we've also got Jinx Monsoon from RuPaul's Drag Race.
Two shows.
Yeah. Four Arms and Hog, Hot Brown Honey. I've said loads of them before. There's also a load of theatre that I haven't seen yet.
Fringefest.com.
Yeah, go to fringefest.com. There's everything you can need there. There's even wrestling. Like,
can't wait.
Are you going to go?
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. You go to it anyway, don't you? I haven't been yet. I really want to go. So I really want to say thank you so much for listening. If you've listened to the end so far, like, this is the first time I've ever done Apricot Party with someone involved here. So if you've listened, just tweet me hashtag Apricot Party, just so I know you're here. But yeah, it's been lovely, lads. Come to my Fringe shows and my Cork Comedy Festival show. I think that's about it. By the way, there's no sponsor. Well, there is a sponsor. This week, right, so there's this girl on Twitter called Bubble Norma. Linda's her real name, right? And it's not Bubble Norma, but she does so much work for ARC, which is the abortion rights
campaign.
Yeah, and she does a lot of work, and this show is actually dedicated to her because she's doing so much work. And because I had a free ticket to Electric Picnic that I was going to offered her, and she couldn't do it because she was doing work for the abortion rights campaign. And they've got a march. When is the march? I'm going to check when the march
weekend?
Is it this weekend? Hopefully it's this weekend, because if it's when I'm in Cork, I'll be very sad. Will you Google
weekend
it for me?
Yeah.
But there's going to be a march, and like, if you're listening and you love abortions, you should come along to this march. No, if you're listening and you believe in a woman's right to choose,
Cork.
Is it going to be during Cork?
Saturday 24th.
Ah, for God's sake. I'm so sorry. I'm going to be in Cork. But Saturday 24th. So if you could replace me.
We have our own one on. You and me can walk up Patrick Street on the Sunday. Because my Cork Comedy Comedy Festival show is the Sunday, is the 25th as well.
Right. So we'll do our two-man march there, yeah?
Yeah.
Lovely. That'd be fun.
Let's do that. We should absolutely
do
that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
But like, so I just want to say thank you so much, guys, for listening. Have a great one. I think I've promoted everything I need to promote. So go on that march, and thanks so much to Davey Reilly, and good luck. Bye.
This has been a production of the HeadStuff Podcast Network.